All right, it's good to see everybody here this morning and look forward to our time of worship together. Time around the Lord's table and then our fellowship meal to follow. Full morning. Let's begin with turning to Psalm 147. Robert's going to come read for us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Psalms 147, the reading of the Lord's Word. Praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God. For it is pleasant, and praise is comely. The Lord doeth build up Jerusalem. He gathereth together the outcast of Israel. He healeth the broken in heart, and bindeth up their wounds. He telleth the number of the stars. He calleth them all by their names. Great is our Lord, and of great power. His understanding is infinite. The Lord lifteth up the meek, he casteth the wicked down to the ground. Sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving, saying praise upon the harp unto our God, who covereth the heavens with clouds, who prepareth rain for the earth, who maketh grass to grow upon the mountains. He giveth to the beast his food, and to the young ravens which cry. He delighteth not in the strength of the horse, he taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him, and those that hope in his mercy. Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise thy God, O Zion. For he that strengthened the bars of thy gates, he has blessed thy children within thee. He maketh peace in thy borders, and filleth thee with the finest of the wheat. He sendeth forth his commandment upon earth. His word runneth very swiftly. He giveth snow like wool, he scattereth the hoarfrost like ashes. He casteth forth his ice like morsels, who can stand before his cold? He sendeth out his word and melteth them, he causeth his wind to blow and the waters flow. He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. He has not dealt so with any nation, and has for his judgment, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we come before you now and give you all the praise. You are worthy to be praised. Our Lord is good. Lord, we pray that you would give us the word today into our hearts. And Lord, let us look to you only in Christ. Father, we thank you for the word. We thank you for the people that are here today and those that are listening around the world. We pray that you be with Brother Ken today as he delivers the word. And that, Lord, we pray that we would receive that word with gladness and joy. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
All right, let's take our bulletins, and on the inside cover, we'll sing this hymn to the tune of O Worship the King.
Salvation by grace, how lovely the song, with seraphim join the feet to prolong. Was planned by Jehovah in council above, who to everlasting shall rest in his love. This covenant of grace all blessings secures. Believers rejoice, for all things are yours. And God from his purpose shall never remove, but love thee and bless thee and rest in his love. In Jesus the Lamb, the Father's delight, the saints without blame appear in his sight. And while he is Jesus, their soul shall approve. abide in his love.
All right, if you'd like to turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 9, Bob's going to come read.
Good morning. Please turn with me to Romans chapter 9. I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and the promises. Whose are the fathers, and of whom are concerning the flesh of Christ came? Who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel, neither because they are the seed of Abraham, are they all children? But in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth, it was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid. For he saith to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will he hardeneth. Thou wilt say then unto me, why doeth he yet find fault? For who hath resisted his will? Nay, but, O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? What if God, willing to show his wrath and to make his power known, endureth with much long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy which he had afore prepared unto glory, even us whom he hath called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles. As he saith also in Osi, I will call them my people, which were not my people, and her beloved, which were not beloved. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there shall they be called the children of the living God. Isaiah also cried concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. For he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because a short work will be the Lord make upon the earth. And as Isaiah said before, except the Lord of Sabbath had left us a seed, we had been as Sodom and had been made like unto Gomorrah. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, have obtained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, had not attained to the law of righteousness. Wherefore? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. For they stumbled at the stumbling stone. As it is written, Behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, and rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity together that you draw us here, dear Lord. Make us vessels of mercy, dear Lord. Be with Ken as he brings forth the message so that you would open our eyes to see and our ears to hear, dear Lord, of our Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, let's take our hymn books before the message and turn to hymn number 35. We'll stand and sing this, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. We sing these. This is actually taken from Psalm 103 in the Scriptures.
Praise my soul, the King of Heaven, to his feet I tribute bring. Ransom heal, restore, forgiven, evermore his praises sing. Alleluia, praise the everlasting King. Alleluia, praise the everlasting King. Father, like he tends and spares us, well our feeble frame he knows. In his hands he gently bears us, rescues us from all our foes. Alleluia, widely yet his mercy flows. Alleluia, widely yet his mercy flows. Angels in the height adore him, ye behold him face to face. Sun and moon bow down before him, dwellers all in time and space. Alleluia, praise with us the God of grace. Alleluia, praise with us the God of grace.
Amen. You may be seated. All right, in the bulletin it says Genesis 47. That's my fault. We're really turning to Genesis 48. If that doesn't get people too confused, Genesis 48. And what we're going to consider here in this chapter is the Father's blessing of the Son. And typically here we have Jacob, who is up in years, getting ready to pass, but he's calling Joseph, his son, to his side. Now remember how this story all began, that Joseph was his favored son. And that was the point of all the jealousy of the brethren. How is it that Joseph has the favor of his father? And all these years later, it didn't change. That any blessing that he was to give was going to be first and foremost to Joseph. And then through him, his blessing on the rest of the sons, as we're going to read in chapter 49 as we get down toward the end of this story. But it's a picture. When you ask in Scripture, who is God's favored son? Well, that voice that came from heaven said, this is my beloved son in whom I well praise. Yes, through Christ, we who are those children that he gave to his son, we're blessed. Paul wrote about that in Ephesians chapter 1. Blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, but always in Christ. In Christ. We're sons by adoption, but he is the beloved, only begotten Son of God. And so, in this story here in Genesis 48, and down through this chapter, we find Joseph verses 1 and 2, hearing of his father's illness, going to visit him, and taking his two sons with him. That might not seem unusual to you, but as we're going to see, these were sons that were born of an Egyptian wife. A lot of people forget that, but Joseph's wife was from Egypt, was an African. And these two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, were by all rights not of the commonwealth of Israel, as you would think. And yet, we find in this story, Jacob, in verses 3 through 7, adopting these as his own for Joseph's sake. So you can see already the picture here of Christ. We're strangers. We're born strangers in this world, and yet for Christ's sake, he considers, God the Father considers us to be his son by adoption. And so he blesses them, verses 8 through 16. Now, there's an interesting story, part of the story, that should hark back to Isaac, Jacob's father, and Esau. Because when he goes to bless these sons, he puts his right hand on Manasseh, who was the oldest, and left hand on Ephraim. And he's about to bless Manasseh because he's the oldest. And what did Bob just read for us in Romans 9? The elder shall serve the younger. Of anybody that should have known how God works, it would be this Jacob and Esau. That Esau was upset that for him the blessing had been stolen, but it wasn't. God had purposed that the elder should serve the younger. So in this story, we see something of God's sovereignty and who he blesses, raising up one above the other, but nonetheless still considering these to be his sons. And then in the last two verses, we see the legacy that Jacob gives to Joseph, particularly because he is that favorite son. So that gives you an idea of where this is going. But let's begin in verses 1 and 2. It came to pass after these things that one told Joseph, behold, thy father is sick. And he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. And one told Jacob and said, behold, thy son Joseph cometh unto thee. And Israel strengthened himself and sat upon the bed. Here again, I see a picture of our Lord Jesus Christ coming unto the Father. And that communion, that fellowship that there would have been between the Father and the Son. And so Jacob, verse 3, said unto Joseph, God Almighty appeared unto me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. Remember how all the way through Scripture, even in the New Testament, Christ speaking of Jacob and talking to the children of Israel, spoke of his father as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and who? Jacob. So here Jacob is recounting that he is who he is only because of God's blessing upon him. Notice, God Almighty appeared unto me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. That's the only way any of us can ever hope to have blessing in Christ. It's going to be because God Almighty, that means he's the sovereign. He appears to whom he will. He blesses whom he will in Christ. And he said unto me, verse 4, behold, I will make thee fruitful, and this is God speaking to Jacob, and multiply thee, and I will make of thee a multitude of people, and will give this land to thy seed after thee for an everlasting possession. So here, what had been said to Abraham and repeated to Isaac in that covenant now is Jacob remembering that all of this is transpiring because of God's sovereign will and purpose. There are people today that don't even want you to go there. They like to believe that somehow we're the masters of our own destination, the captains of our fate, but such is not the case. That everything that unfolds is according to God's purpose, what he purposed to do. And we are looking at this of the blessing of Jacob with his son as a type of the father and the son. But we know, reading through scriptures, that Jacob is also a type of that one favored of God. And in Malachi it says that it's because of God's mercies that you sons of Jacob are not consumed. In his flesh, Jacob was nothing but a planter. That's what his word means, his name means. And yet God was pleased to favor him for Christ's sake. And when it says there, I will make of thee a multitude of people, it's not talking just about physical Israel. But there is an Israel that is not of Israel. Again, Romans 9 is what is the commentary in what we're reading here. That this people that here is described, the fact that Joseph was preserved alive, that he might save many people alive while he was brought down into Egypt, it was exactly for this reason, that there be that people that would be preserved and through that seed, the Lord Jesus Christ would come. And because of him, it says he'll give this land to thy seed after thee. And that he has. If you go back to the land of Israel over there today, there is that land that continues to exist. And you wonder why when you see all the enemies surrounding it. It's a sliver of a land. I think I measured one time, I figure out the measurements are no more than 80 miles wide at its deepest part and 120 miles north. And that's like from here to Ruston and then go north up, just north of Texarkana up there, and that's the size of Israel, the land, with enemies all around it. And yet, there's the people of Israel in that land. What does that speak to? Not Israel's faithfulness, that's for sure, but the faithfulness of God. And I believe it's going to stay that way all the way to the end of the world. As God said so, as long as the moon shines, the sun rises, he would be faithful to that land. Now, man and his pride over there, they think, well, we're still favored sons of God. No, there's only one favored son of God, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ alone. But they hate him. To this day, they will not hear him unless they're one of the remnant that God has been pleased to redeemed by the blood of his son. But God is faithful, and that's what Jacob is recounting here. And even as sons of Jacob, we must see ourselves in this, that if God has been pleased to be merciful to us, it's like Bob read again in Romans 9, that commentary, I'll be merciful to whom I'll be merciful, and I have compassion on whom I will have compassion. You can't even look at yourself and think, well, it's because I did this or that that God's being favorable to me. No, that's foolish thinking. For Christ's sake, it's because he purposed it. Jacob is recounting here the covenant mercies of God toward him. And the fact that there's even this relationship between him and Joseph is because of those covenant mercies. Else, when Joseph, for him, was a lost son, he died. In his eyes, that's all he knew. And suddenly now, to discover that he was alive, and not only alive, but by him, God was saving an entire people alive. But I'll tell you that it's a picture as well of God's covenant grace in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, toward sinners such as we are. Without that, there is no salvation. It goes all the way back there to eternity. And everything that we're reading here is the beginning of the unfolding. That's why I love reading the scriptures now. The Lord having given me eyes to see, this is a history of redemption. His story. His story. And we see it here in the initial plant that's growing up. And soon the flower blooms and it all unfolds with the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's the beginning of that story. So there's a picture there of God's covenant grace and mercy in Christ. But now, in verse 5, And forward, I see a picture of adoption. That adoption that is in, through, and by the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he came, Joseph came specifically to Jacob with his two sons. And he says in verse 5, "And now thy two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, which were born unto thee in the land of Egypt, before I came unto thee into Egypt," look at here, "are mine." God does not make any distinction between those that are his by his grace in Christ Jesus. There is a people that God has purposed to save from every tribe, nation, and tongue. And even here in the Old Testament, all the focus is on Israel, Israel, Israel. There's some people that have a problem because they say, well, this is a mixed marriage. Joseph was married to an Egyptian woman, so therefore not a pure Hebrew Hebrew. Oh yeah. Look how Jacob spoke of these two sons. "Before I came unto thee in Egypt," he recognized that God had given them these sons. And he said, "They're mine. They're mine." And look at what he says following there. "As Reuben and Simeon." Reuben was the firstborn. Then Simeon. So in order, you would think, well, if people like to talk about birth order today, well, this is the heir up here. Nope. Jacob is saying they're just like Simeon and Reuben unto me. "And they shall be mine." Aren't you glad that God doesn't show favors with regard to his children? We do. We tend to look at this one and think, well, how on earth could that one be a child of God? I look over here and think, ooh, I can tolerate them, but I'm sure not going to live with them. I'll tell you what, there's going to be a people throughout eternity from every tribe, nation, and tongue that Christ has redeemed. And if you've got a problem with living with them now, there might be a problem as to whether you're even there. Everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. I believe this is an area where the Lord deals with each of his own. Where we look upon one, if we know that one the Lord has redeemed, we embrace them as a brother, just as God has embraced them as his adopted children. There's a beautiful picture here of adoption. He says in verse 6, "And thy issue which thou begettest after them shall be thine, and shall be called after the name of their brethren in their inheritance." So here he's looking upon Joseph, and even that seed that should come from this seed, that no matter how long time endured, they would be considered as being his children. He says, "As for me," verse 7, "when I came from Paddan, Rachel died by me in the land of Canaan in the way." Why does he bring up Rachel? Well, that was Joseph's mother. And the other one was Benjamin. Those two that were born of Rachel. The rest were Leah's, and they were handmaidens, but this one specifically. And remember, Jacob loved Rachel. He embraced Leah because that's the one Laban tricked him into getting, but his heart was ever on Rachel. So he's reflecting now in his old age about how the Lord took her. "Rachel died by me in the land of Canaan in the way, when yet there was but a little way to come unto Ephrath. And I buried her there in the way of Ephrath." The same is Bethlehem. Isn't it interesting that Bethlehem here is mentioned, that even though Rachel died, that seed did not die. And this seed would continue all the way down to that one who would come from this seed, which is Christ. Bethlehem. Here he's bowing to God's sovereign will and all that he purposed in his life. So Israel, verse 8, beheld Joseph's sons and said, "Who are these?" That might surprise you. He's asking because Joseph had already presented them and he knew them to be the sons of the Egyptian mother. But I see this many times as for the Lord to draw out of Joseph Jacob knew who they were. But to draw out of him that declaration that these are mine. I think about what Christ said, "Behold, I and the children whom thou hast given me." This was an occasion for Joseph now to own these and to stand by them and to be their advocate. Notice all the way down through here, I don't read where Manasseh or Ephraim said one thing. This is Joseph speaking on their behalf. And I think about how when we are presented before the Father, as if the Father would say, "Who are these? Who are these that you, the Lord Jesus Christ, are representing?" It's like in these marriage ceremonies when the officiating person says, "Ask who is it that gives this woman to another?" It's not like anybody's wondering. They're making a declaration of identification with that person. And here, Joseph said unto his father, verse 9, "They are my sons." Do you know how precious that is? To know that before God the Father, we have an advocate. That we don't have to. This is not by self-proclamation or confession where we declare our sonship. No, it's our head, just like Joseph here, declaring these to be his sons. "These are my sons whom God hath given me in this place." Relate that the same to how it is we're accepted. It's in the beloved. "These are my sons whom God hath given me." How is it that any are the Lord's? It's because God has given them to his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. They're blessed in him. So he said, "Bring them, I pray thee, unto me, and I will bless them." Back to Ephesians 1. Every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. As you read down through there, through verse 14, our election is in him, our adoption's in him, our redemption's in him, our sanctification's in him. It's all in him. And that's how we're blessed. Just like Jacob saying, "I will bring them, I pray thee, unto me, and I will bless them." It says the eyes of Israel were dim for age, verse 10, so that he could not see. I'm sure at this point he's probably thinking back to Isaac, his father, when Isaac could not see. And Jacob, to receive the blessing, covered himself actually in the sheep's and goat's skin, to feel rough like Esau, where when Isaac felt him, he said that it seemed to be like Esau, but the voice was that of Jacob. And here now, Jacob being blind, the eyes of Israel, that was the name that God had given him, and blessed were dim for age, so that he could not see. Thinking that Jacob's probably remembering that time with his father. You say, "Well, how does that relate to God?" I will tell you that in one sense, God is blind to emotion and to feeling and to other things that might influence an individual or person. Just like we say, justice is blind. The fact that Joseph was the one presenting these to him, though he could not see them in the flesh, yet it was because of Joseph that he was about to bless these two. In that I even see a picture of our Lord Jesus Christ. Where does God look in order to bless any that are Christ? It's to his son. It's hearing the voice of his son. And there is nothing that could ever be said or done to deter God from blessing those that are his sons. We sang a little while ago that hymn in our bulletin. I don't know whether it impressed you as it did me, but the last verse of that hymn we sang, "In Jesus the Lamb, the Father's delight." It's like Jacob here, his delight was Joseph. These sons of Joseph. The saints without blame appear in his sight. So blind in the sense he does not see our faults and our sin. It's not what he looks to justify. He looks to his son. And here's the truth. And while he is Jesus, their souls shall approve. God shall approve their souls so long as he is Jesus. Well, how long is that? That's forever. So long shall Jehovah abide in his love. Sooner it would be for Christ to cease being the Son of God than for the Father to ever cast off one that the Son represents. I don't know about you, but that gives me a lot of comfort. Because I know myself to be undeserving. We can dress up and put on a good front, but I know my heart. I know who I am, a wretched sinner before a holy God. I can't even, if you were to ask me right now to define God's holiness, how on earth could I ever define it? And yet you say, well, Ken, where's your hope? It certainly isn't in my profession. It's not in my persevering. And it's not in my preaching. Whatever other P's there might come. It's in Christ. And the fact that in Christ, God's blind to anything else. It's the voice of his Son that rejoices his heart. And it's the voice of the Father that rejoices the Son. So he says, he could not see, and he brought them near unto him. Notice again, who does the bringing? He didn't stand back and say, okay, Ephraim, Manasseh, now get on up there. He brought them near unto him, and he kissed them and embraced them. Who is it that brings us near to the Father if it's not the Son, in whom he's well pleased? I'm so thankful that's the case. And Israel said unto Joseph, I had not thought to see thy face. And lo, God has showed me also thy seed. What is the most vital thing to God the Father? It's his Son and that seed that he has given to his Son. What a blessing. So Joseph brought them out from between his knees and bowed himself with his face to the earth. And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near unto him. What you're seeing here, remember, Manasseh was the firstborn, and Israel was the second, or not Israel, but Ephraim was the secondborn. But Joseph purposely brings them and puts Ephraim to where Jacob's right hand would be on him, the younger, and Manasseh, his left hand, would be on, I'm sorry, on just the opposite. Ephraim in his right hand, the younger, toward Israel's left hand, Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near. I'm getting those two mixed up. And Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it on Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head, guiding his hands wittingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. And he blessed Joseph and said, God, before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac did walk, the God which fed me all my life long unto this day, the angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads, and let my name be named on them, and the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. And when Joseph saw that his father had laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. And he held up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head unto Manasseh's head. And Joseph said unto his father, not so, my father, for this is the firstborn. Put thy right hand upon his head. And his father refused and said, I know it, my son, I know it. He also shall become a people, and he also shall be great, but truly his younger shall be greater than he, and his seed shall become a multitude of nations. And he blessed them that day, saying, in thee shall Israel bless, saying, God make thee as Ephraim and as Manasseh. And he set Ephraim before and has put the younger above the other. And Israel said unto Joseph, Behold, I die, but God shall be with you and bring you again into the land of your fathers. Moreover, I have given to thee one portion above thy brethren, which I took out of the hand of the Amorite, in my sword and with my bow. So we can see here how God sovereignly purposed that the younger would be blessed above the elder would serve the younger. And as I said, Jacob clearly would have understood this in doing what he did, himself having been that one that was the younger, yet the Lord was pleased to bless him. God's sovereign. He can do what he will with his own. But the thing that I read here, that even though in the natural outworking of this blessing, because you can read how indeed the younger Ephraim was greater in number, in multitude. In that sense, God multiplied him above Manasseh. I have some references here that we could look at, but Numbers chapter 1 and Deuteronomy 33:17, you can see how this was fulfilled. But the point that I want you to see, that even though that was so physically, yet in this case, unlike Jacob and Esau, Esau sold his birthright. He was outside of the covenant, and Jacob was blessed. In this, even though God purposed that the younger should be above the elder, yet it says there that Father, in verse 19, refused and said, I know it, my son, I know it. He also shall become a great people, and he also shall be great, but truly this younger shall be greater than he, and his seed shall become a multitude of nations. But what you want to see is verse 20, and he blessed them that day. No distinction, even though God purposed in providence that this one be more numerous than the other, yet in Joseph they were his. I see that in just how God in his providence raises up his people, called a remnant, in different places. Some you'll see more here than here. But if Christ is their representative, if Christ is the one who has paid their sin debt, if they are in Christ, then we're all alike, accepted in the beloved. And that's where the blessing. In thee, verse 20, shall Israel bless, saying, God make thee as Ephraim, and as Manasseh. And he set Ephraim before Manasseh. I know the disciples with our Lord would argue about who was going to be the greatest. And even when it seemed like John would not die, it seemed to indicate that he would live the longest, and they wanted to know more about that. You remember Christ said, what is that to thee? Follow me. Our eyes are not to be on each other, wondering why this one seems to have more of God's blessing than that. I'll tell you, if we're in Christ, there is no difference. That God has blessed, as he said, he blessed them that day, knowing that through this seed, God would, preserving this nation, that God would bring his son. So he said to Joseph, Behold, I die, but God shall be with you and bring you again to the land of your fathers. What a blessing to know that in Christ, as here in Joseph, that we find the blessing of God. We've often said that the work is done between the Father and the Son. Manasseh and Ephraim, they were beneficiaries of this blessing. They didn't say a word here other than to hear what was being said between the Father and the Son, between Jacob and his son Joseph. And if we ever wonder where it is our blessing, it's not in our determining. It's not in us attempting to say something or to influence either. No, it's a bowing to what God has purposed in and through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that the Lord will make that a blessing for us today. Let's take our hymn books and sing hymn number 67. How can it be, in light of what we've just heard, who am I? The Lord should be gracious and merciful unto me. We'll stand and sing this and then partake of the Lord's table. Hymn number 67.
Oh, Savior, as my eyes behold the wonders of thy might untold, the heavens glorious light array, the vast creation thou hast made. And yet to think thou lovest me, my heart cries out, how can it be? How can it be? How can it be that God should love us so like me? Oh, how can it be? As at the cross I humbly bow and gaze upon thy foreground now, and view the precious maiden form by cruel nail so bruised and torn, knowing thy suffering was for me, in grief I cried, how can it be? How can it be? How can it be that God should love us so like me? Oh, how can it be, was ever grace so full and free? From heights of bliss to depths of woe, in loving kindness thou didst go. From sin and shame to rescue me, O Lord divine, how can it be? How can it be? How can it be that God should love us so like me? Oh, how can it be?
Thank you. Maybe see. I love reading the different renditions of the Lord's table as they're taught in the Gospels, the different Gospels. Here I'm reading from Luke 22, verse 7. It says, then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed. So this was the Jewish Passover. This is what the Lord had given to Israel. Celebrate their deliverance from the land of Egypt. Spiritually, as pertains to what we're doing here, it's a picture of our deliverance through our Passover lamb, who is Christ. But what strikes me here is the simplicity with which we are celebrating, not with fanfare, not with pomp and circumstance, but with two elements. It's like what was vital in that old Jewish Passover, even though there were herbs and there was the lamb to be slain that was part of the feast, yet the only two elements that remain today are what? It's the unleavened bread, because that's what was celebrated. No bread with leaven was to be eaten. And the cup, which represents the blood shed of the lamb. That's it. Why just those two? Well, because the bitter herbs are done. There's no more suffering that is necessary for Christ. He doesn't have to come back and suffer again and again for this fulfillment. It was one time. And there's no lamb to be slain because Christ the Lamb was slain. But what's left are these two elements. And so, as the Lord, verse 8, sent Peter and John, saying, go and prepare us the Passover that we may eat. And they said unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, behold, when you are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you bearing a pitcher of water. Typically, it was the women that carried the water. An unusual circumstance here with a man. Follow him into the house where he entereth in, and ye shall say unto the good man of the house. I don't believe the Lord used that word just in general, but here was one of the Lord's, a good man, in the sense by God's grace and goodness, one for whom he would soon be paying his sin debt, but having this house. And tell him, the master saith unto thee, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished. I love that. That what this represents in the person and work of Christ, a large upper room furnished, there make ready. They went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And when the hour was come, I love those parts of Scripture, when the hour was come, everything unfolding exactly as God purposed. Even Christ in the flesh, he did not cease being God. He was directing all things to this end that the Father had given him to accomplish. When the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him, and he said unto them, with desire have I desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Think, from all eternity, God purposed that this hour should come where he himself would be the fulfillment of what every one of those Passovers represented. You talk about something historic that we're celebrating here. It's not just a tradition. It's been nearly 2,000 years that this table that we're partaking of was instituted by our Lord Jesus Christ in memory of him. But Christ said, of all of those Passovers, this is the one I've desired to eat with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not eat any more thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. If you're thinking kingdom of God is still in the future, then that means it's not been fulfilled. But that's not what he's saying. What he's saying here, speaking of this being fulfilled in the kingdom of God, he's speaking of his death. When he should lay down his life, that lamb shedding his blood, God's lamb. John the Baptist preached that. Behold the lamb. So someone asks, well, where's the lamb? I see the bread and I see the cup, where's the lamb? The lamb was slain once, forever. What we have here is this cup that remembers that blood shed. How important are these two elements? So it's been fulfilled. I'm not talking about some kingdom in the future. It's talking about him having fulfilled it. And he said, I'll not eat any more thereof until it be fulfilled. Now it's fulfilled. You say, well, where is he eating this now? Well, he's present. Even as we partake, he's present in the hearts of his people, partaking with those that he has redeemed. And so he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. There again, when did the kingdom of God come? Came in his person, but it was fully established, the foundation laid, when he laid down his life, died and rose again, and sent on high. He took the bread, gave thanks, and brake it, and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you, this do in remembrance of me. When he said, this is my body, he He's not saying that it becomes his body by some sort of magic. There's some that actually believe that, that through incantations and things that this turns into the body of Christ. But he's talking about it as a picture. This do in remembrance of me. It'd be like if I took a picture of myself and said, see me? I'm holding the picture. And you're saying, no, that's not you. I see you. Well, it's a representation. That's what this is. This do in remembrance of me. You can't remember someone you've never known. So if someone asks, well, should I partake of the Lord's table? Who is the Lord to you? Has he been revealed in your heart? Do you know him by the Spirit of God to be the Lord and Savior, the one who shed his blood to save wretched sinners such as we are? This do in remembrance of me. That's what we're remembering. We're not remembering our goodness, we're remembering his. That's why it's unleavened bread. There's no sin in him. Sin was laid on him, but no sin in him. It may surprise you in verse 20 when it speaks again of the cup, but the first cup he took was the Passover cup. That was the last time he took it. That's why I said, I'll not eat or drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come, until this is fulfilled. He fulfilled it. But now, this cup, verse 20, is the cup that we have that he gave us in remembrance, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Again, remember, a testament is a will and testament. It's for those who are named in that will. But it's in his blood, and he says, which is shed for you. That word shed means with specific purpose. There was an execution that took place there on the cross. Had Christ not come to pay the sin debt, there was nothing in him that would ever have caused him to ever die. He would have continued to live forever in that perfect body, which is represented by the unleavened bread. But the reason he died is because there was an execution. God the Father put upon him the sin of his people. Therefore, it required him that he should die. Justice be satisfied. So that's what we're remembering. He took the bread and gave thanks and break it and gave it to them. And then he took the cup the same way. Giving thanks and gave it to them. This do in remembrance of me. Gracious Father, as we partake, I pray that your Spirit would turn our eyes to your blessed Son. Not on ourselves, there's nothing good in us. Not on each other, there's no one here to whom we dare even compare ourselves. But our eyes on your blessed Son, the one that you sent in the fullness of the time and made a woman, made under the law, that he might redeem such as we are that were under that law's condemnation. Being redeemed, there is therefore now no condemnation. So that's what we celebrate. And we do this until you come again, remembering the person of your Son, his glorious, holy, righteous, and his work that shed blood. It was required that you might be a just God and Savior. Oh, may our hearts ever rejoice in him and him alone. In his name I pray. Amen. Let's take our hymn books and turn to hymn number 110. Close our time of worship and then hope everybody can stay for our meal together. Hymn number 110. Alas, did my Savior bleed? Did my Sovereign die? Let's stand and sing this.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he behold that sacred head for such a worm as I? Was it for Christ that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing. Well, by the sun, in darkness high, and shone his glory then. When Christ the mighty Maker died for man, the creature's sin. But cross of green can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do.
Amen. All right. We'll get things together and ready to eat.